And so she enjoyed cooking and enjoyed making food, preparing food. She didn't want you to leave unless you had some of her food. And I'm told that her banana pudding was out of this world. Those of you who, anyone here never had her banana pudding? Just me. Okay, everyone else has had it. That's good. And I'm also told that you would get a nice refreshment of her loose leaf homemade sweet tea that was legendary. And so people would come really just to say hello, but really to get a glass of tea. That's why they really came by to visit. When they had meals, they had full meals at the table, which is kind of a rarity today. But the idea of family gathering together around the family table, and if you went in their home, she was going to keep that home spotless, which is another rarity today. And so she truly was a homemaker. When she wasn't keeping the home and raising her children and feeding friends and neighbors, she loved to garden. Whether she was raising her own vegetables, like one said, these gigantic squash that she would raise, or the beautiful flower garden that she really enjoyed, the different flowers and kinds of things that she could do. These were her hobbies in addition to the cooking that she did. She also loved to shop. She was not afraid to go shopping and going out. She loved the outings with friends and family and going out and spending the day shopping. She loved being with people. And usually, if you're an acquaintance of Barbara, you became a friend of Barbara's. And if you're a friend of Barbara's, then you became like family to Barbara. And that's the way she dealt with people. That's why she was so endearing to so many. She also, whether she was at a luncheon or a shopping outing or a road trip, all of these encounters were ways that brought her endless joy to life. She really, really enjoyed going out and being with people. And if that weren't enough, she also kept children as a private child care, oftentimes with after-school programs, with neighbor kids, with family kids, and anybody that she could come into contact. And when she taught them manners and she fed them and she just shared her love with them and cared for them, she also taught them how to play Old Maid and go fish and how to play solitaire and dominoes. Somebody recounted that they were playing dominoes when the sun came up. That tells you something about their remembrances of her. So she was always getting the game. When it came time for Halloween, she was the Halloween witch, which doesn't seem to fit her motif, but that's what she would do, would be the Halloween witch during that time. She gave comfort to the hurting, and when some of the kids would get hurt or whatever, the obituary says she gave one of the wildest horsey rides you could have. She'd put you on her leg and give you a wild horsey ride and try to turn that frown into a smile and get into the laughter and forgetting the hurt and pain and problems that they were having. Many of the summer vacations that the family took were road trips to see family in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And I think I'm told that Bruce was kind of like my dad and my granddad. We're going on a trip. We're starting at this time, and we're not going to stop unless we absolutely have to until we get to that time. Oftentimes, they're looking at their watch and telling me how long it took them. Well, he was kind of one of those guys. I'm going to get the beeline west. And so Barbara would go in there and pre-make some sandwiches and food and things for them to make that trip and to carry their way all the way to Albuquerque. And when I think about that, I think about all the family bonding that can be done on a long road trip. And there's nothing like a long road trip through West Texas to get to Albuquerque, New Mexico. I'm saying that facetiously, if those of you who haven't been there yet. But I tell you, having bonding experiences with a nice family in a small sedan, you know, that's just a lost art today, really. But that's what they used to do. She lost Bruce in 2015 after 47 years of marriage. And when you think about a life of 76 years and having all those occasions and things, just so many people that she felt like were family, it was really important to her and significant to her. She is survived by her daughters, Regina and husband Jeff Banks, Veronica and her husband Steve Jennifer and her husband Terry Andy Jr. She is also survived by sisters Sybil Brown and Odessa Trout, sisters-in-law Barb Jack Myers, Janice Jack Anderson, and Regine Jack, and grandchildren Amanda and Clay Banks, Caleb Jack, and Gwendolyn Ann, and a handful of nieces and nephews, Quentin Brown, Patricia Martin, Angie Brown, Dean Kaufman, Gail Conway, Paul Kaufman, Leonard Kaufman, Deborah Mattingly, Ronnie Clary, Rhonda King, Carol Trapp, John Anderson Jr., Ryan Anderson, Gene Myers, Kathy Myers, Christy Waldroff, Cora Nixon, and Jim Jack, to name a few. If I didn't have that list, I would have never gotten through that. But, and fortunately, it didn't have any crazy names that I couldn't pronounce. So, you know, the scriptures tell us in Psalm 31, a wife of noble character is kind of important in life. And it says here in verse 10 through 12 and following, a wife of noble character, who can find? She's worthy far more than rubies. Her husband has full confidence in her and lacks nothing of value. She brings him good, not harm, all the days of her life. She is like the merchant ships bringing her food from afar. She gets up while it's still dark and provides food for her family and portions for her servant girls. I'm sure Barbara would like to have some servant girls, but she raised some servant girls. I think that's what she did. She considers a field and buys it. Out of her earnings, she plants a vineyard. She sets about her work vigorously. Her arms are strong for her task. She sees that her trading is profitable, and her lamp does not go out at night. She opens her arms to the poor, extends her hands to the needy. She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue. She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children arise and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many women do noble things, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceptive, and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her the reward she has earned, and let her works bring her praise at the city gate. Also in Proverbs 14:1 says, the wise woman builds her house with her own hands, but with her hands, the foolish one tears hers down. It's the homemaker who makes homes. In fact, I like to say they turn a house into a home. They're the ones that turn just a facility into the warmth of a home. And this, the scripture says, is a wise thing to do. But the opposite is contrary to that. The foolishness of those who sabotage their own homes and tear them down because of their foolishness. I would say in our world today we could handle a few wise homemakers, particularly if they are famous for their banana pudding and their sweet tea. We can always use a few homemakers like that. Let's pray together, shall we? Heavenly Father, I thank you today for Barbara Sue's life. I thank you for just the way she showed herself as a wife, as a mother, as a friend, as someone involved in her church and her community. And Father, how she was able to look at people the way Jesus looked at people and to see the value in their lives and to draw them near and to use her gifts and talents and abilities to draw them closer to her and then also hopefully to you. We thank you that on this occasion that as we bow, we are in grief and we are in sorrow because we miss her. But we thank you so much for her investment of life and the blessing that she has been to each of us and the way that we can take that blessing and remember that blessing for our own lives and to know that we are one with her and also with you, but also to know that example that she set before us is also available to us so that we too can live the kind of life that brings you closer to others. We pray that you'll continue to be with this family as they grieve, strengthen them during this time. And Father, as we celebrate her homegoing and we understand this life that she's living, has lived before us, we pray, Father, that you would honor this service in a way that would bring honor and glory to you. For it's in Jesus' name we pray.
I his face, the one who saved me by his grace.
She would always call me handsome, you know. Hey, handsome, welcome, you know, and that. And it just made me feel good that she would do that for me. And so I'll always remember that she always called me and referred to me as handsome, you know. And, so that made me feel good, you know. I kind of have a couple of little memories. One is when I was probably in the third or the fourth grade, so that's back in the 70s. You know, disco was popular. And I didn't have a lot of the things that the other kids might have had and would have made me feel on the same level, so to speak. But I remember she gave me a gift, and it was a white belt, you know, one of those pistol belts. I guess it was probably 3 inches, you know, wide. And man, I wore that thing to school when I got that next Monday morning after that weekend of getting that gift, and I just felt like I was on cloud nine, and I'll always remember that. Because that was kind of a little piece of what she did. She always tried to make me feel good. You know, growing up with, I was the only boy. I had, you know, three cousins that were female. And I had two sisters, so I was just the only boy. It was a bunch of girls, so I had to do my part and be honoring. So I was always honoring to you guys. I know I was. But I think it was those times when she might have called me a handsome devil. So, but anyway, I'll miss you, Robert. I miss you, and I'm sure you're doing great where you are now, and that's the way that brings peace to me to know that. So anyway, thank you for the time.
Thank you, Robert. All right, anyone else?
Absolutely.
Come on up here, sir.
Let me speak from here. I talk loud.
Okay.
So,
but I don't hear good.
Well, I was a downstairs neighbor of Barbara's at the Concord Village. I've been there about a dozen years. Most of these ladies were neighbors also. Now, I feel neglected in some way because I never had any of the banana pudding or the sweet tea. So what I did get, because I had several conversations with Barbara, is always a good smile, and she and I made fun of different things and all that, so I always left with a smile on my face, and she was fun to be around, and I know all of us will miss her very much, because she was just candy corner right up, and I would tell her, if my TV's too loud, you know, let me know. But it came as a shock to us. But I know my life is more enriched that I was able to become friends with her. And I thank all the ladies, and my good friend Richard Garrett can say the same. We were all close and tight-knit there at the Concord Village Apartments.
Are you John?
I'm John.
I'm
John. Yeah.
I'm
Well, thank you.
Thank you for sharing. We appreciate you sharing. Veronica, you're supposed to be over here, aren't you? No, I'm just
well, this lady right here is
special, special. Well, I just know that you're the butterfly. This
well, I am. I'm everywhere.
That's awesome.
Mom's older sister. And this lady right over here is Mom's younger sister. And I just am such a
all right. Good deal. All right, anyone else? This is your time to shine. Maybe somebody else was a handsome devil in here. All right. I saw some of these ladies last night over at a visit last night, I think. So, sounds like when she went over there, she met some great people. And, of course, Barbara's going to make everybody family, right? So, you all became part of her family. That's awesome. Yes, ma'am. Come on. Come on up here. Do what?
I was in Barbara's great bunch.
Thank you for sharing that. A schoolmate is here. That's awesome. I guess she keeps friends throughout her life. What's the deal with that? All right, anyone else?
Mama did not believe in throwing anything away. It didn't matter if it was friends, food. She did not like throwing anything away. She kept everything.
I think there's a scripture that says, waste not, want not, right? And so you may live by that. Anyone else? I'm going to put this up. Nobody's going to use it. All right. Well, I was asked to share a passage of scripture at this time. Thank you all for sharing and enriching us with your relationship with her and your understanding of who she was. Psalm 51 is a psalm that may be familiar to some of you. It is the psalm, really, of confession that David made after he had his bad sin in life. And the idea that we're not all perfect, we all make mistakes, and Barbara understood that, and she was still friends with people and walked them through life and those kind of things together. And so it was thought that this was, might be an interesting passage for us to all contemplate, because a worship service like this in the time of a funeral, part of it is the remembrance of the one that we love and care about, but part of it is you and I have a day left, or another week left, or a month left, or however long we have left, to take from lessons from someone that's passed, that's influenced our lives, but also maybe to draw in this quietness of this moment, maybe some things that will help us to advance our lives as we move forward. Well, David wrote this psalm because he was upset at what he had done. And he says, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me against you. You only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are proved right when you speak and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Surely you desire truth in the inner parts. You teach me wisdom in the inmost place. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will turn back to you. Save me from blood guilt, O God, the God who saves me, and my tongue will sing of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise. In your good pleasure, make Zion prosper. Build up the walls of Jerusalem. Then there will be righteous sacrifices, whole burnt offerings to delight you. Then bulls will be offered on your altar." Let's pray together, shall we? Father, as we have heard the testimonies of others who have been influenced by Barbara's life and have been impacted by her warmth and her love, her joy of life, and to enrich lives that she touches, we are thankful again for those testimonies and those experiences and the example, again, that she's been to us. Father, knowing that none of us are perfect and all of us have sinned and fallen short of your glory, we are mindful of what David had to share about his own sin and his desire to have it blotted out and his desire to be washed clean that he might live a life that's pleasing to you. At this juncture of this service, we pray, Father, that that might be true for us as well. We all know that we have failed, but we pray that in our failure, we would confess it and give it to you so that you might strengthen us, encourage us, and provide for us the wisdom we need to take the next step ahead in our lives and to live lives that reflect you in all we do so that we might draw others to you. We pray in Jesus' name and for his sake, God's people's sake. preparing this message for today, I was mindful of Barbara being a homemaker, and she's kind of a generation of homemakers, and that is not a lauded profession today among women or in our country at all. And yet, there's such a significance to someone who invests in the lives of her family and her community and those kind of things. We oftentimes look for quotes from industry leaders or from corporate moguls or all these kind of things. And this part of the service, I like to connect us to her in some way and maybe learn some things that the Lord has for us and use her life as an example of that. Abraham Lincoln once said, "The Lord must love the common man because he's made so many of us." And, you know, the idea that what she did mattered and has had an impact not only in your lives but those that weren't able to be with us today. And so we're mindful of these kinds of life lessons. Not only was she a good friend and a good person, those kind of things, but she took all of that and had a relationship with the Lord. And so I want to share two or three scriptures that I think probably were meaningful to her and helped her in her life together, and I hope will be meaningful to us as well. So these life lessons are from a Christian homemaker, if you will. And the first lesson is this: wisdom comes from God for the asking. James 1:5 says, "If any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him." The sense of wisdom is important in all of our lives and all of our decisions of life. Whether I'm a homemaker or a titan of industry or whatever I'm doing, I need wisdom. And oftentimes I need wisdom beyond my own training, beyond my own education, beyond my own understanding. And so sometimes to be able to read situations or to understand what people are going through or walking in those portions of life, I need a wisdom that is beyond me. And Barbara had this relationship with Jesus, and she knew him well, and she knew where her help came from. And so whenever she had a need for wisdom, she knew where she could turn, where she could bow, where she could pray, and ask the Lord to help her in life. And no matter what roles we hold or what hats we wear, we need this kind of wisdom in our lives. We need it to be effective and to become all that God wants us to be. The Lord, the scripture says, will give generously without finding fault, but we have to ask him. And part of the idea of asking him is understanding that he is the one that has that resource for us, and understanding that he is God in our lives. So wisdom comes from God for the asking. Secondly, we need to see a need and meet a need. When you're a housemaker or a homemaker even, it's not enough to see something and say, "Well, I'll get to that later." Usually, something else is going to come up later. There's going to be another thing to do later on. A homemaker's work is never done. There's always another meal. There's always some laundry to do. There's always some cleaning to take place. In addition to her hobbies of gardening, there's always going to be some tilling and some pulling of weeds and all these kind of things to make these things become what you want them to become. So when you see a need, you meet that need in any way. Well, guess what? That applies not only to the stuff we do around the house or the stuff we do at work, it applies to the people that we encounter. When people come to us and they have a need and we see that need, it is incumbent upon us, as particularly as believers, to try to meet that need as best we can. I've found in many conversations, if you sit down with a little bite to eat and something to drink, people loosen up, and then the real things come out of what they're struggling with in life. You know, Barbara probably was so great at banana pudding and sweet tea because she makes so much of it. You know, because she was always preparing it and having it ready and sitting down with someone and visiting with them through that, not just for the food and the drink, but also the opportunity to have the encounter and the engagement. And then maybe revealing some things there where she could help in her life. You see a need, you meet that need. People have needs for conversation. We're relational people. We were created to be relational people. We have need for interaction. We have need for a good listener. who not only hears the words but understands what behind all of those words. We need someone to play with, even if it's dominoes, even if it's go fish. You know, we need someone to enjoy life with. Her ability to balance these things with the wisdom of the Lord provided fruitfulness in the way she lived her life and impacted people. You know, it's Solomon was super wise and supposed to be one of the wisest men in the world. And he said in Ecclesiastes 9:10, whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might. For there's no work, no planning, no knowledge, no wisdom in the grave where you will go. We're all going to die someday. We're all going to pass through these portals someday. So while we're here, all the planning, the work, the knowledge, those kind of things, whatever your hand finds to do, you need to do it with everything you've got. I think that's an example Barbara showed us. Being the best kind of homemaker, the best kind of mom, the best kind of wife that she could be. If it matters, do it now. Some of you may have the gift I have, which is called procrastination. You may know what that means. You know, if it can be put off today, it can be put off tomorrow as well. You know, but that's not really a good, solid strategy for living life, because there's always something that's going to come up, something for someone to do. Then the third idea about this is to meet the need like you were serving the Lord. The scriptures say here in Colossians chapter 3, if I can get to it here. In Colossians 3, there's my Titus passage, here we go. Colossians 3, 23 and following says, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as working for the Lord, not for men, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. Anyone who does wrong will be repaid for his wrong, and there is no favoritism. In this passage of Scripture, we see this idea that we meet needs not because it's our job or our duty or something we have to do or something that's on our plate, but we do it as if we're serving the Lord Himself. So when you came to visit her and to sit down, it's as if she's having a conversation with the Lord, or you're having a conversation with the Lord flowing through her. Do it with all your heart, not just going through the motions. We only have so much time on this earth, and then it's done. And so the idea is that whatever we have to do, we need to see it, we see a need, we meet it, and then if we're going to do it as if we're doing it for the Lord. So we're doing it with our best efforts. We're not just going through the motions or checking off the blocks or saying I did this, but we're actually doing it with some love, with some concern. And I think that's how Barbara went through life. There was love in what she did, in the things that she did. Keeping a house immaculate doesn't mean that we aren't able to do that, but she did that because she loved the Lord, and that love went through her, through her children, through her wife, through her family. And so she did her best, is what she did. She did it with all her heart. And we do it with the knowledge that our inheritance comes from the Lord. Not only are we doing it as if we're doing it for Him, but we know in the end we go to meet Him face to face. And we know where that reward comes from. And so I still want to do it right. I do it without regard or without excuses. It says there in that scripture, wrongdoers will be dealt with. So I don't have to worry about wrongs being dealt with me. In fact, the Lord says, I will repay. Revengeance is mine, says the Lord. I don't have to worry about all that. So if somebody does something bad to me, that's between them and the Lord. What I have to do is to live a life that's pleasing to Him. And so it's without regard or without excuses or allowing wrongdoers to be my excuse. Well, nobody else does it, so therefore I don't know. I do it because I'm serving Him. My inheritance comes from Him. And I still do it right, even though the circumstances may not be right. And then fourthly, I'm training up others who will follow me. And that's what the scriptures in Titus have to say. In Titus chapter 2, verse 4, it says, then they can train the younger women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled and pure, to be busy at home, to be kind, to be subject to their husbands so that no one will malign the word of God. And so there's this sense of several things that are mentioned in this passage to love their husbands. I don't think there's any doubt that Barbara loved Bruce with all her heart. And part of the serving the food and the keeping the house and doing the garden and making the dollar stretch and all those kind of things are all actions filled with love. To love the children. I think these daughters love their mama, and I know that mama loved them in return. And she cared about each of them. Scripture says to be under self-control. The idea is that I didn't get off the pathway, but stay on that pathway. To be pure. Her motives were pure. What she did was pure. To be busy at home, and yet be kind. You know, sometimes when I get busy, I'm not that kind, because I'm just trying to plow through what I'm doing. But to be able to do that and still be kind to those around you, it takes some strength. It takes probably some special touch from the Lord. And then to do nothing to undermine the Word of God. To try to live an example of life that would draw people to God rather than push people away from Him. And everyone that I've talked to that's known Barbara would see that as a draw. And see Barbara as a draw to the Lord. She did her best at living at these principles. And I think her life stands as a testimony to her efforts in that way. And this was her testimony to her faith in Jesus, that not only provided for her forgiveness of sin, not only provided for her eternal security, but also empowered her with the wisdom to live daily while she was here on this planet. And so she is a blessing to all of us, not only for who she is, but also the example she leaves that can be followed. Someone who loves the Lord and then allows that love to flow through them into the lives of others. It's my prayer today that all of us will learn something from her that we can pass on, some example from her that we can pass on, not only apply to our life, but pass on to our loved ones. And so that love gift keeps on giving through each generation. Let's pray together, shall we? Heavenly Father, I am mindful of Barbara Sue Jack and her life. I know her mainly through her children, and yet they have risen and called her blessed, and these examples that have been seen today remind us of how much she loved you, how much she loved them, and the things that we can learn from her to help us to live lives that are pleasing to you. Again, I pray for each family represented here. I pray for everyone here. I thank you for their attendance. And I know that it wasn't by accident that they're here today. And I pray, Father, your word would speak to minds and hearts throughout this room and beyond, so that not only would her life be well lived, but that through her life we could learn, and that our lives might be well lived, and we would pass those lessons on to each generation. Father, continue to guide and direct us throughout our time together here today. And we pray, Father, for your healing hand upon this family, and that you draw them near to you, and that they might sense your presence as you continue to guide and direct and minister to them. We pray in Jesus' name. Thank you. at the what's going to be the final resting place of what we knew as the shell, the jar of clay, scripture says, of Barbara. But the Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So I'm going to tell you, Barbara's not here. This is her shell. This is that thing she used and abused while she was here. And so this is where we will bury this, and we'll have a stone. And like you have stones out here, it helps us be reminded of someone who lived in our life. It's an opportunity for us to come, for some people to pray and to remember and reminisce and all those kinds of things. But you're not going to come back here and meet Barbara here. You want to meet Barbara, you're going to have to go to heaven where she is right now. She's with the Lord. And so this is a great opportunity for us, though, to be mindful and to remember, because some people need remembrances and opportunities to remember someone. But all of us have memories, and they're not all going to be about when she passed. They're going to be a lot happier than that, and when she was of the joyful self, and when she was competing in her Go Fish game. Y'all never compete against each other in Go Fish, did you?
No, we didn't compete.
Oh, you did?
From each other. We tried to be a lovable family.
Man.
Until she got mad and came at you with her fingernails.
Like, oh, is she the Oh, Barbara's the fingernailer. Okay. Well, man, nobody gave me that testimony.
She's the baby sister.
Oh, that's funny. No, that's... I love what she said. We tried to love one another. I like that. I like that. Well, the idea of love is where I want to go with this. And Paul, when he was writing to the people at Rome, he was writing a deal, and they had never met Paul. They knew of his ministry elsewhere, but they'd never met Paul. He'd never been to Rome. So he writes this whole book we call Romans to let them know what he knew about Jesus and everything he knew about it. Because ultimately what he was going to want was Rome to send him to Spain. That's where he wanted to go. He never made it there. But his idea was he was going to go to Rome so that they would sponsor him to go to Spain. What turned out, he got arrested and he went to Rome in chains. And we have these letters from him. But it's like he's telling the Romans, he's trying to figure out what could separate us. In verse 35, he said, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ?" And he's trying to think about it, dream about it. Shall trouble or hardship, persecution or famine, nakedness, danger, or the sword? As it's written, "For your sake, we face death all day long. We're considered as sheep for the slaughter." No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of Christ that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Now I want you to feast on that thought for a moment. There's nothing created, nothing out there that can separate you from God's love. And Jesus said it this way, once we've been placed in the Father's hands, no one can pluck us out. So we have this relationship. Well, there was a day when Barbara placed her trust in Jesus and put her hand in his hand. And Noah can pluck her out. And now today, her body will be buried, but she will be with the Lord because of the promise that he gave. And Paul's trying to tell the Romans, man, nothing can separate you from God's love. So receive it. Well, then we get to the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation. And the Apostle John is talking. And he says, in his vision, he says, "I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eye. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away.' He who was seated on the throne said, 'I'm making everything new.' Then he said, 'Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.' He said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To him who is thirsty, I will give him drink without cost from the spring of the water of life. He who overcomes will inherit all this, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. Now think about the newness. There's going to be a new heaven, a new earth that's untouched by sin, untouched by death and sorrow and pain and suffering. There's going to be this new place. He said, I'm making everything new, and he will be right there with us as we live our lives. That's where Barbara's headed. That's where she's going. That's her inheritance. And that is the inheritance of every one of us here who have come to trust Jesus as our Lord and Savior and have established a relationship with him because he drew us in to the family. And the one who drew us in, we can't be plucked out, and will take care of us even through eternity. And like that old hymn says, when we've been there 10,000 years, we've no less days to sing God's praise. The idea that I could be somewhere 10,000 years and haven't lost a day, that's a pretty good picture, I think, of eternity. And so that is her inheritance, and that is ours for the keeping if we come to trust Jesus. If we want to see Barbara again, that's where we'll see her.
She's already planting her garden.
She's probably got a garden there, and the Lord probably gave her some really nice property for that to happen. And so it's an awesome thing to come to hear, to know that we remember Barbara and all she did, and when she got me with her fingernails and all those things right there. But we also remember the blessing that she was in all of our lives, and we're thankful for that. And we thank God for that gift. Let's pray together, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank you again for Barbara Sue Jack, for the life that she lived, the influence that she had, and we thank you that in her life she made you known. Her love for you shone through her to our lives. We thank you that everything she did, whether it be cleaning a house or making some food or planting a garden or playing a game of solitaire, whatever it was, Father, she did it with all vigor and excitement and joy, and she displayed you in the way she lived her life. I thank you for this family, and I ask now that you help them in this time of grief. May we realize that grief is only for a season, and as we process through this grief, that there are ways that you want us to take this and use it as fuel to live lives that reflect Jesus in all that we do and say. I thank you for each person here, their commitment to you, their commitment to this family. Ask your blessings upon them. Guide and direct us in all that we do. We'll be careful to give you all praise, for it's in Jesus' name we pray.